Hello everyone, welcome to episode 18. We are discussing fundamentals of research in medicine with Professor Fikri Abu-Zidan. Today's episodes we will discuss about how we can answer reviewers' comments properly. So, Prof, what would you like to say to our students?
The rebuttal, or we call it responding to the reviewers, is really an art. The more you work in publication, you know, the more you really take care of it. Because I can tell you, especially for those difficult revisions, the main factor in getting your paper accepted is your letter. So you will get the answer. Sometimes you get it early morning, sometimes at night. And then it's an exciting moment because you want to see what the editor and the reviewer said about your paper, your peer. And let's say the great moments, the happiest moments, and tab is less than 1%, is that your paper is accepted without revision, which is unusual. I can tell you from my experience, 0.5% maybe can be accepted without revision. The reviewers, if you have especially three reviewers or even two reviewers, two people will not agree on something. So definitely they may like the paper, at least they will tell you this is wrong. Even there may be linguistic corrections, commas, dots. They should show that they looked to the paper deeply. So the happiest thing I find if I get minor revisions. Okay, that's achievable. And usually this can be answered quickly. And sometimes they ask you specific things that you need to work on them. So my advice is really don't ignore any advice or comment from the reviewer. So you do exactly what they want if you agree with them, or even if you think there is no harm from doing it on your paper. So even if you disagree a little, because this is like, and this is like an opinion, you can follow their advice if you can, because the principle is make the reviewer happy, because at the end they will judge you. I mean, if you think it's really scientifically not accurate, I'll show you how to do that, how to disagree with them. But please, if they give you an advice, listen to it, because they spend the time, and most of the time is free arif. And it doesn't look nice. These people spend this time and say, oh, I don't listen about your opinion. Anyway, the journal is owned by the journal. It's not by you, and you are asking them to publish your work. So you have to go by the rules, unless you think it's not scientific or non-ethical, which is not the case. If it's a minor revision, if you will be surprised, I will address it as soon as I can, even same day or next day.
Again, the same principle, you want to keep this paper on the editor's
table. And I want to finish it, I mean, not in a rush, but I just want, because I know I can answer this. Sometimes it takes up an hour, sometimes full day, it doesn't matter, but I just want to think about what is coming next. Now, the revision, the other decisions which really need more work, they can be major revision, reject and resubmit, which means in principle this paper is not accepted in the current form, but they give the review, the author a chance if he wants to do other more work, maybe do more analysis, collect more patients, so he can resubmit. And there is one advantage for that, Arif. There is no limit for the time submission. It's different from revision. The revision is a good thing that, okay, I can address this. And sometimes the time is so long for the revision. I had one revision of a systematic review. It took from me 3 months. And usually the time they give you 2 months. So you have to write to the journal at one stage that, please, I need more time. This is really major demanding, and I have to revise actually critically all the papers. So it took 3 months to do it. Yeah. But then you have to write to the journal, because the system here, I can tell you about the systems electronic, if they take you out from the system, it's you have to resubmit again, which is a difficult process. So please don't wait till your submission time goes, and then you will ask, they will ask you to resubmit a paper with a new number, which means that another review process. So although this is a small trick, write to the editor asking for extension. It can save you a lot of time. Now, major revisions can be very tough. So I really, once you read them quickly and you get really stressed, I cannot do that.
At the moment, at
least. At the moment. Don't do that. Just relax. Go enjoy your time. Absorb the shock. And you will get some reviewers very tough. But the author, the editor likes your paper. And he gives you a chance to rebut. So take a breath. And then come back to the questions after 24 hours. And then be systematic. You put all the comments, number them. 1, 2, 3, up to 40. We have sometimes 45 comments. Some of them are difficult. And then you know, once you read them, you know the task initially, okay, I can answer 60%, maybe 20% I will struggle, 20% I will not. Some of them will be difficult to answer. And I'll tell you how to address these that you cannot answer. So we use what's called the Swiss cheese eating technique. And please, this is a very good technique. I use it usually and it's very, very useful. And how do you do that? You try to make holes in the cheese. How do you make holes? By addressing the simple questions. Sometimes it's linguistic. So you start correcting and enjoying these things. Then please modify this. You do it. So you see, okay, you've taken.
You're actually, progressing.
You are now acting. So now, and emotionally and psychologically, you are now positive. I finished 10, although they are minor, but they increase your emotion to finish it. Now, once you finish that stage, now your mood is much better. You make a plan for the other ones. The first process. Making some holes in the cheese may take 1 or 2 days. Now, the second stage, you have to plan. Sometimes there are specific things that need the help of your colleagues. Yeah. We got a request from a paper from Journal of Trauma to get the red blood cells used in pelvic fractures. So you need to go to the files. Yeah. So meanwhile, you ask someone to go and get data for you parallel. We call it in management parallel function. So not sequential. So you try to think, okay, we can do this, we can do that.
But somebody has to take care of that part while you are actually answering the other part.
Yeah. Sometimes they tell you the image is not good. So you have to go and search for a good image or alternative image so you can really put it. Now, some of the questions are really tough. And with slow thinking and really concentrating, you can address some of them. Let's say part of them you cannot answer. It means major study on it. Then what do? You acknowledge. You thank the reviewer for this raising this point, and you acknowledge it in the limitations. All these points that I cannot answer, I can put that. We didn't answer this. We don't have that. And you put it in the limitations section. That would please the reviewer too much. Yeah. Now, the situation, if you don't agree with the reviewer, and I have this repeatedly regarding statistics, because not all people are really trained in statistics, Arif. And sometimes the reviewers are not aware of certain misconceptions. What I say usually for the people I train is simple. You can rebut in a polite way and make it a scientific discussion. You don't attack the person. You attack the argument or you critique the argument. And I always say, do you want the grapes or do you want to fight with the grape guard? You need actually the grapes. So be polite, and especially, for example, reviewers may not know a lot of statistics.
Yeah.
And then you try to rebut in a polite way, explaining why you think this approach is not proper, and thanking the reviewers, first of all. We thank you for raising this point, which is not clear, but etc., etc., and the reference is so and so. But don't make it personal.
Yeah.
Don't really make it personal. And then you will be surprised to see how things at the end of the review will suddenly go so quickly, more than you expected. And that's actually what I call the Swiss cheese technique in answering the reviewers.
Yeah,
they shouldn't be in the same sequence.
Yeah.
You can just jump from here, from there, whatever you think, and gradually you get the mood and you can attack them. Sometimes it takes 1 week, sometimes 2 weeks, sometimes 3 months. The most difficult situation, which I don't advise people to behave like what I do, is that whenever the paper is rejected and you feel that the editor, the editor will listen to the reviewers, but the reviewers actually either they are not knowledgeable about the area or their decision was not accurate, maybe you didn't clarify what you want, then you can rebut to the editor, rebut the decision, and ask for an appeal. And out of 370 manuscripts, we did it only in 11, which means less than 5%.
All accepted, or some of them maybe?
Out of 11, only one not accepted. All 10 were accepted after rejection.
This is another art, probably, too.
Yeah, I don't advise. I usually, the people who observe me, I mean, I like to involve you. Please don't do that. You can spoil your relationship with the editor if you really reject a paper and then say, oh, you don't understand, or the reverse, don't, and they are right. I only did it in 11 occasions in my area of expertise. I'll tell you an example. We have a paper, a global paper, the students can go to it and see why it was rejected and how I did a rebut. It was in World Journal of Surgery. It's a global pedestrian study. And then they told us, and of course, data up to 2010, but because of the World Health Organization, so it was up to 2013 that we received this data. So 2010 is published 2013. So we sent the paper exactly 1 month after the data was out, because we were waiting for it. So the reviewer told, this is very old data since 3 years. Why they don't have new data? And he rejected the paper for that reason. And I wrote a letter directly to Professor Hunter, please. Professor Hunter was the editor. There's no more new data. The WHO process takes 3 years to publish a report. And that is the most recent. And believe me, he pulled out the rejection and they accepted the papers and they published it. So that's a genuine reason. It's a misunderstanding of the reviewer that the data were old. They were not old. The process took 3 years to be published as a WHO report. And if you feel really that there's something not fair, and you need to be really experienced to do that. Shall I do it or not? But my advice to you is not really to argue too much with the editor. The editor is like a judge. He takes the final decision. You can appeal to the judge if you want. But try to find another journal that is suitable. This is my advice for people who are start. You will learn by experience when really to say, no, I think the decision was not right.
Prof, I have a couple of questions. Every time I saw you, when you respond, 99% of the time, the paper is going to accept it. But in case if it is rejected, you are not changing your paper for any other journal, and you are just preferring to send the same, the written, form as it is, to other journals.
Interestingly, I mean, if I get an answer, this is of local interest, or there is nothing new to it, you cannot do anything
about it.
And then there is nothing to correct. But when do you correct? You have to read the comments. If there is a mistake, you have to correct the mistake.
Yes.
But, Arif, I can tell you something. If the methodology is good and people agree on it, everything else is an opinion.
Yeah.
From my own experience, I can tell you, when I was young, I listened to the reviewers and changed the paper as they want, and I sent it to the next journal. The next reviewer told me, this is completely wrong, and he asked me to change it to the first
one. Yeah.
If you know the difference between methods and opinion or discussion, this is easy in your mind. Now, why I send it directly, I put a list of papers, because I know the methods and the question is there. If people are interested in it, they will ask us to make the changes. And then the changes are made with a direction to please the reviewers, so it's invested properly to be accepted and to go for the next one.
Yeah.
So that's why, not out of arrogance, or overconfidence. I've been well trained in methodology and accustomed and updated myself always in methodology. If there is a methodological issue, I would listen to them. I'll tell you two examples of that. I've been doing a statistical analysis that I learned in my PhD. If you have repeated times between two groups, I was doing ANOVA analysis, and many people do it. But Professor Nico told me, this is wrong. You should have used repeated measurement analysis. Then I learned from him and I changed the whole paper and accepted, and then I learned new things. So it's not arguing. Sometimes I get comments. One of the great reviewers I can tell you about him is a paper that I did in injury for modeling. And then I got the comments of the reviewer. Oh my God, although I'm a statistician, I was so impressed by these comments. It took me some time to to refine my methods so a good researcher would know the comments are genuine or not genuine. So you just don't listen just to reviewer, just to recent reviewer. You should be convinced that these are there. And if it's an opinion, I wouldn't invest a lot of time because opinions differ.
Yeah.
But how do you overcome that they don't come back to you? Please, in your discussion, don't be biased in selecting specific articles that actually support your opinion. Try to include the...
Yeah, comparing, contrasting with
the others. And actually, what you cannot guarantee that if you do this, that the opinion of the other reviewer...
Yeah.
It will differ. So if a reviewer accepts a paper and he critiques the discussion in some way, you modify it.
Yes.
But if you do it, are you sure that the other reviewer will not be a different opinion?
Yeah.
So because when a review is useful, if it tells you there is a methodological issue, there is something wrong in the methods, there's something in the results, the presentation of the results, but not in the discussion, actually.
Prof, the one last question. In the document of the responses to reviewers' comments, any recommendation about
this? Prof, you remind me also of a mistake I learned. Professor Graham Hill, who is a very authority in nutrition in New Zealand, gave me a very nice advice, and I give it to you. I carry his advice to you. Please be as short as possible in your answers. Because the more you speak, the more problems you open to yourself. So you have to be short, answer the question, exactly like an exam. Now, I thought that if you are short, even you remove the question. So I used to say, okay, point one, and then I give the answer. And I think this, the reviewer will know his questions, but it delays the revision. What you do, you write the question, and how did you answer it in a precise way. You don't give the whole answer. You say, thank you for this comment. This point has been discussed and it's available in paragraph page. And then you highlight the changes in the manuscript in yellow, for example. The other thing, people think that rebuttal, they answer the reviewers to convince him. No, that's not rebuttal. Rebuttal is to answer the reviewer in the manuscript. So if you make a change, you change it in the manuscript. If you disagree with him completely, you really answer him without putting it in the manuscript. But most of the time, you make the changes in the manuscript.
And refer in that refer change in the, yeah.
As short as possible, as polite as possible, as organized as possible. And always start with thanking the reviewers. I mean, we thank you for this great, also we disagree with them. We thank you for this advice, or we thank you for raising this point. And this, or because it raises concerns, or ambiguity of the language. Sometimes they tell you this is not clear, you have to rewrite it.
Yeah.
So the reviewers, I mean, if someone volunteers to help people, this is from his good intention. And maybe, I mean, you should really learn from, and some of the reviewers made our papers great.
I was going to ask you, actually, what is your percentage in your mind? How many percent of the reviewers comment in your experience, 40 years experience, is really, valuable to change or improve the paper?
No, I always listen to them. I mean, I always listen to
them. So you can say 70-80% of the time, what they actually say?
No, I mean, the reviewers' comments most of the time are really... Rarely I really... I mean, I remember exactly the time when I didn't accommodate the reviewers' comments. Even in the mutations, I can them. But sometimes, for example, I had to remember a reviewer from surgery who didn't know the difference between parametric and unparametric methods.
So you have to explain.
And I explained for him the difference between ranks. And he was so polite. And he really accepted the paper directly. But he's a human. We are all humans, Yanni. Now, sometimes, recently I told you, there is a paper that the reviewer said, I don't understand this advanced statistics. There is a statistical editor who can address these issues. So we are experts in some areas. We have to acknowledge that we are not experts in other areas. And if you need, usually in revision, Arif, as you've seen, we work as a team. I didn't say that, which is very important. As the team is responsible for writing, they are responsible for revision. So we sit together, the first thing we do, we make a strategy. How to address everything, we divide, you do this table, you do that, so we work as a group.
Yeah.
And that saves a lot of time, and of course we know that group intelligence is much, much, much higher than individual intelligence. So even the reply will be much stronger if you work as a team.
I agree, Prof. Prof, thank you very much for this episode again. I think it is very valuable information already shared many times, and it's great. Thank you so much, Prof.
Thank you very much, Arif.